DSA's best practices meet. And as you all know that this is a theme-based cybersecurity event. Last 4 or 5 years, we have been trying various different themes, starting like, for example, 3 or 4 years back with SMAC, mobile security, data science. Last year, the theme was a cognitive security. This year's theme is primarily the platformization. And platformization that we have been witnessing in many of the technology domain, and each of the technology plus each of the things are now getting platformized. And security itself is also getting shaped because of the larger trend of platformization. We'll have to discuss this particular platformization during the course of these 2 days. And entire this session, the theme and the different discussion that we have planned is primarily meant for that one. And one of the important enabler of the platformization is the cloud. Cloudification is very important key enabler of the platformization. And then cloud implementation as it is happening, is primarily there are multiple approaches that people have been deploying for the platformization. And these approaches needs to be really dissected, studied, and investigated to see what exactly benefit they bring to the table to all of us, what exactly it is really shaping entire the technology industry and use of technology industry actually, and use of this platform which is we have been looking at, and then see the discussion of the platformization primarily enabled by the cloud from the perspective of security and privacy. So just to kick off this entire then best practices meet, so as we usually start our events with a pre-event workshop. So workshop is a kind of a format that basically we have to investigate, pick up one area, investigate into the very deep level, and then when you are investigating and examining that particular area, we need to be having very engaged and interactive discussion with some of the lead speakers that we have with us, and probably we can bring our experiences to this discussion. And to just capture our experiences, we have also shared kind of a questionnaire which you can fill. And while sharing that, filling that questionnaire, you may not like to fill your name on your organization's name, but more importantly, those questionnaires is meant to get some insight, some views for the content that we are trying to bring it to the table. So this particular workshop, we usually are thankful to those organizations which helps us to bring the content for this workshop and probably engage the community, security community, in a deep dive kind of a particular area. So Palo Alto came forward to help us with this is one of the important key critical content of this particular theme of platformization security. And to take us through the entire cloud journey, the way it is happening, the approaches that people have been deploying, the train that is basically evolving, we have Suvin from the Palo Alto who would take us through the content that he brought to the way the businesses are deploying the cloud. And there are multi-cloud models that have been existing and people have been experimenting with. And in those environment, we need to look at how exactly the discussion of security and to certain extent privacy also get changed and get influenced because of this kind of initiative. And what we need to do in terms of securing that. So the format of this discussion is, he would be taking us through some of those slides, the content that he brought to the table. During the course of discussion, I will myself will try to ask or probe this particular area from my side, what I understand. And I'll also invite you, basically, to talk about your experiences and what you basically think about this one content area. So this is a kicking of the best practices meet. And as I talked about, the platform is a key critical element of this particular best practices meet, and there is no better way to start the discussion with the cloud and where the clouds are being implemented by the different set of the organization and for different purposes as well. So to start with, I request Suvin take us this content, but before we come to this particular formal discussion, briefly I would like to talk to and probably engage with you and take your views, what exactly you expect out of this workshop, and see whether we can pick this content to address some of those questions and observations and some of those expectations that you have. So briefly, if you can talk about your expectation out of these 2 or 3 years of the engagement that we'll be having on this particular topic. So anybody would like to talk about this topic and a kind of expectation that you have on this workshop? So this will help us to set up the context well.
No expectations from this workshop at all today? Or all of you
yeah,
still?
Yeah, there is a, can you just pass the mic here?
So it's audible, right?
Yeah, it's working.
So
you'll need to turn it up a little. Keep yeah, it, you can start talking. They've already.
Yeah. So primarily, I'm looking. The takeaway from this session would be like how Palo Alto networks are today, today actively proposing their solutions, okay, as SaaS, okay, and also how they are actively working with the cloud vendors like AWS and with your Azure, because I see a lot of work around with Azure. It is in terms of integrations with Azure Security Center and others. Like, what is that you are doing today with AWS and how?
It's not audible yet.
So, yeah, is it now?
Yeah.
So, typically, from the SaaS perspective and from IaaS perspective, it is so. How your cloud security solutions has progressed and took the advancements it is.
It's good, good, interesting point that he's expecting that basically the way the cloudification is happening and different cloud implementation is happening and how exactly security solutions are catching up with. That's the basically that
yeah,
you have.
From the, Palo Alto, okay.
Yeah, means we may not talk about Palo Alto much here. We will be talking about the architectural approaches that are deploying getting deployed and how the network security solution approaches like a Palo Alto had been looking at this particular transformation to the cloud from the enterprise.
So when we look at, right, so how these security vendors today, right?
Yeah, okay, so how security vendors are responding
working
to...
Working with the cloud vendors and how they are trying to bring up that security services, right, by integrating. The important aspect is that, you know, people are looking, right? Clients are looking towards the cost-effective solutions, and vendors are offering native security controls, which are not completely matured, right? So to the level and expectations that is looked at, it is.
Yeah.
So, okay, the entire agenda is to look at, at the overall, right? What is that? It's happening, okay, from the vendors. Like security vendors and how they are working with the cloud vendors to come up with this secure like advanced security offerings, right? So this is something one of
So I think this is a good context to the discussion. Yes, you have something. And just pass the mic. You need to look at the volume. Volume is not really good.
My name is Anish. I would look forward to get some insights on. On microservices-based systems or system which is divided into microservices, how to secure that, and some insights from you guys. And
So the larger architectural change which is happening, which is called the mesh network and microservices network, and basically how exactly the network security.
How to secure that?
That's a very interesting point.
And some
point
thoughts on your any multi-tenancy testing approaches. You know, if you have some thoughts about it.
Yeah. Any other? Yeah.
Thank you, Anish.
The second row.
My name is Ramesh. So I would like to know what type of security measures we should take when we deploy open source based cloud products. That is one aspect. The other one is...
Can you just hold the mic near her?
Yeah, open source based security tools.
Okay.
And how I will deploy and take care of security when I deploy an open source based product. That is one aspect. The second is that in a multi-cloud environment, I would like to know that whether it is multiple platforms we are going to talk about, how to secure them, or private public cloud model. In that model, if I deploy in multiple models, how I have to secure?
Yeah. So when we talk about multi-cloud, I think private cloud and public cloud discussion becomes an important part. Yeah.
Yeah. Hi, Shivdas here. Slightly different take. You know, you're talking about business, and I've been in business and moved to technology. And one of the biggest issue which we typically face is during the run session. Like when your system is up and running, not during the design. You have an incident or you have a breach, then how really at that point of time you do the sort of changes and it doesn't really affect the whole security model.
Yeah.
Because you quickly apply a patch because everything is running at a high speed. We are talking about hours and minutes when we need to quickly bring the business back up, right? Yeah. At that time, you make the changes. So what's the compromise which happens there, you know, if you could help us understand? Because I've been in 20 years in the business side and moved to the technology because of my business experience, and that's the only expectation they always have.
How quickly do you
You are, and without compromising.
Without compromise.
Because after that, again, you can't be down because they are answerable globally.
I'll make a note of this. I don't have slides or anything covering that, but
we'll
discuss
try
this
to, we'll
the,
try to cover
yeah,
this
the
point.
Yeah. Best, how to handle that scenario.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Done. Yeah.
Any other, like that corner?
Yeah. We are entrusted with some unenviable task of integrating applications running in different clouds, maybe in Tata or Amazon or even the government cloud. So what are the security, you are any case studies, use cases, and security challenges and solutions?
So sure. Different applications that are running on the cloud, and how exactly we are
doing this? Because the integration, data synchronization is expected.
So synchronization of data.
Data,
so that's,
because
yeah.
And not through web services and all, it should be direct link.
Sure.
So, without any latency, without any time delay.
Yeah.
Anything
one
else?
Question. Can you hear me? You can hear me?
Yeah.
You can hear me?
Yeah.
Okay. See, when
you have to hold that little bit.
A little more closer.
Yeah.
Okay.
Can I have power for my laptop, please?
When we talk about securing multi-cloud, one is, of course, most of the cloud security providers, like the Azure, AWS, and Google, and all that, have quite a bit of security features in them itself.
Yeah.
But then there are now quite a few other product vendors, because now like probably 2018, things are mature, but maybe 2-3 years back, the things were not so mature, and there were a lot of other products around saying that we will add this much on, you know, security for your cloud. So will your talk be talking about, should we just go with the CSPs for the entire security features, or should we also be having products added on?
Yeah, and this is an important point. So there is a native security abilities of the cloud application and mini service provider. And against that, how the security product industry had been really responding to that one. So are they complementing and probably competing with each other? So that's something is a very important point to discuss.
Yeah, so that I think has reference to do with the number of OEMs that we are seeing in RSA recently, in the sense that a cloud provider will have its own native security, and you have niche players coming up delivering separate security controls. So how do you look at integrating all of that together for comprehensive security posture? Addressed, we'll do that discussion.
Yeah.
Anything else?
Anything else? Any other point? Any other initial? Yes.
I mean, during the course of the workshop, I will try to keep it as interactive as possible, because there's a lot of feedback that we need from you specifically. We as Palo Alto Networks are, if you look at us, we are more in the US than here. And a lot of content that is delivered across the globe is more US specific than in India. So this is one of those forums which allows us to get feedback directly from industry people like you with respect to what you are expecting, where the Indian market is headed as far as security is concerned, and what type of solutions you would want us to bring in so that we can actually make your security journey a little more effective. So.
Yeah, well, what I'm looking for is, apart from what others spoke, is when you're reviewing a security solution in a situation where there's a multi-cloud world. So you're looking at a surface area which is exponentially larger than all of them put together. So what are some of the first principles based approaches? What I'm looking at is more of a technology agnostic approach. Some of the nuances that can go into in such reviews.
I didn't understand that.
Some nuances of a technology agnostic approach that can go when you're looking into this scenario.
Correct.
Where there's a security framework being designed in a multi-cloud environment.
Yeah.
Yes.
So you are talking about the footprint and surface of attack is increasing because of the multi-cloud environment.
Strain.
And
yes.
What are the principle-based technology agnostic approach to take care of that? So, okay.
Yes.
Any other point before we go to the formal presentation? Okay. I think that sets the context of it, actually. And
I think
some of them we may require to dwell into because they may not have covered in the presentation. But I believe most of the points that we have been talking here would have cover in the presentation.
Yes.
But during the course as well, it's not only the initial part. During the course, any point in time that you basically have anything in the mind or any question to be asked or comment to be made, please feel free to do that one. So that's how we should be spending these 2 hours, next 2 hours with each other. And with this, I think I will request now Suvin to initiate or commence with the presentation.
Thank you very much, sir. And thank you everyone for being here. It's nice to see a full house, especially when Argentina had to play until 1 o'clock to win yesterday night. So thanks all of you for being here. My name is Suvin. I'm a systems engineer with Palo Alto Networks. I'm based out of Bangalore. And in case all of you are from Bangalore, you guys can run into me anytime and I'll be able to help you for any security solutions that you have. So without any further ado, I'll set the context first. I do not intend to do a lot of talking here. There are a lot of slides that I can cover, but I would like to hear from you, like I gave you an indication sometime earlier. So there is a segment that covers public cloud, there is a segment that covers private cloud, and there is a segment that covers SaaS applications, which was what one of you were asking. So for as far as Palo Alto Networks is concerned, our approach to security has been that security, point number one, should not be looked at in silos. It means that the moment you have multiple different parts of your infrastructure coming up, one in cloud, one in public cloud, one in private cloud, one in your own environment, all of that, in case you have a siloed approach to security, it will not work. You need to have a security platform for it to actually function and deliver comprehensive security. That is why the theme of our discussion today and the theme of the next 2 days workshop is basically platformization of security. Convert security into an operating platform that can deliver outcomes to you, not ask you to make configurations on the fly, not ask you to do a lot of change management and operations and all that. So while I start off, I have a quiz for all of you at the end of this. A couple of these questions will be taken out from here. So, and I would request you to, so this is what, can you just shift over to my slide, please? This is what we intend covering. So cloud, finally, dollar maker. A lot of institutions and organizations have moved to cloud for the purpose of making up dollars. How cloud is impacting business today? Public, private, SaaS, and hybrid clouds, understanding the baseline that all of you have set for your organization's move to cloud. Security in the cloud era, a deep dive on public cloud security, private cloud security, and SaaS security. And where we as Palo Alto Networks are headed in the future to bring together all these facets of security under a one common operating platform. So this is what I told you. I'll give all of you 2 minutes. All of you who have an Android or iOS phone, please go to the Play Store or iOS Store and download the Kahoot app. In case you can, what we'll be doing is there will be questions that will be posted up online and you'll need to immediately answer them. The fastest finger gets the biggest, gets the highest score, and you'll be able to, and the top three people who score the highest at the end of the 10 question quiz gets goodies from us. So this is just, this is not a Palo Alto Networks quiz per se. This is not, how do I put it? It's only a mechanism of making it a little more interactive. So all right to go ahead. Do you guys want maybe a couple of minutes to download the app? So I'll leave that for now. Please go ahead. Kahoot is the name of the app. Kahoot.
Maybe any of these kind of applications will be people asking question about the data is collecting and whether it's tested for security.
So you don't need to give your data in the sense that your phone, it identifies your, what is that? It doesn't look at your records or your, so when you register it, Android actually gives you the options of what data it collects, no? So I'm sure it doesn't collect any data there.
Yeah. Yeah.
So good to go?
Yeah. I think during the course they will keep doing it.
During the course.
So your choice is not a compulsion to be part of
it. No compulsion to be part of it. It's just fun, nothing else. I didn't want it to be a too dry a session today. And with respect to the questionnaire, in case you aren't too open about sharing your corporate credentials or your company data and all that, don't need that at all. It is only for us to create a baseline with respect to what customers in the region are doing with their clouds, so that we can address your requirements better. I hope that's clear. Moving forward, how many of you agree with this statement? Your data, which was earlier within your private data centers, has now moved from your private data centers across IaaS, PaaS, SaaS, correct? How many of you use public cloud today? Like I said, I'll be asking you to all put up your hands once in a while. How many of you use public cloud today? 15, 20. How many of you use private cloud deployments of NSX, ACI, stuff like that? And how many of you use SaaS applications? Neat. So which basically means all of you have delved into cloud in one format or the other. More or less right. So if you look at the statistics on the screen, this is a report that Palo Alto Networks had published, I think, in around February or March 2018. This was the adoption rates of the various SaaS or various cloud applications over the last 1 year. So if you look at it, functioning as a service, 56% was not, only 10% were totally adopted. SaaS applications was the maximum adoption rates that we've seen. Infrastructure as a service followed with a close second. Platform as a service, third. Business processes as a service, fourth. And then finally function as a service. I guess the last two are something that is just coming up now.
Yeah, is it because function as a service or business as a service is still evolving? So there is not much offer that comes from their side. And whereas in case of SaaS, most of the SaaS players like a CRM, ERP, HR applications had been very much evolving in terms of applying those kind of solutions to the marketplace.
Correct.
So that is, it's not only the adoption side, it's also the supply side actually. So that must have been a reason in some cases where now BPOs are now been talking about. For example, we mostly know about, we talk about BPO as a BPM now. So that is basically business process as a service now. So that transition started happening now. And going forward, that will basically increase in the coming years to come.
Yeah. So how many of you actually have heard of a function as a service and have started adopting stuff? Can you give me a bit of insight of what you're doing? Okay.
Odd zero. Usage of odd zero.
Okay.
I think that was an excellent usage, and I'm sure it's going to become more prevalent going forward.
It will. It is expected to be. So, like I said, everything that we see on the screen is in various stages of adoption, like what Sir was saying. It might be because it evolved later. It is under the process of evolution as such. Now, let's move one step forward. Now, we've understood that exactly like what you guys told me. There is a large move to SaaS. There is a large move to public cloud. Now, let's understand the primary security concerns that are there. How many of you agree with what you see on the screen now? What is your, I'll take maybe three answers. What is your biggest concern when it comes to your data moving to cloud? Three answers. Anyone? Confidentiality. All right. You come under the 53% bracket. All of them. What is your top one concern? Data leakage. Right. So 67%. Anyone more? Data privacy. So that's anything other than these three that comes to mind? No? So other than that, what we saw was visibility was one very, very key factor. When it comes to data that moves to cloud, a lot of organizations lose visibility with respect to what data moves to cloud. Is my understanding right? Because when, let's assume you use Office 365. How many of you use Office 365? A few? 8, 10? So once your data moves off to Office 365, how much of visibility do you have into that data? Very little. You seriously don't know what data is going there. So visibility was very, very a very key concern that a lot of organizations had when it comes to security.
No. There is another one point.
Yep.
So this data sovereignty and control, anybody has any view on that? This is also a very important concern. We may not be having those concerns, but some people would have the concern.
Which
so
means?
What exactly it is? What basically it talks about?
AWS data center, Microsoft data center not in India, so I can't send data.
So those are the concerns that data going out of the country, out of the border, is also a very important concern for the cloud. And you yourself may not be expressing those concerns, but there are many policy makers and government bodies would like to have, would like to talk about data going out of the country. Hello? Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, I mean, because of these concerns, now cloud providers are coming with this kind of architectural arrangement where data is stored inside the country. Yeah. Yes.
Yeah, as a different perspective, as I said earlier, from business side, I see cost as a concern over a period of time.
Yeah.
You get moved into this, or I will put it as you get sucked into this whole game of cloud, then you can't easily get out. I just see that happening 10 years down the line.
Yeah, cost overruns. So basically, I guess I agree to that to a certain extent because I was in a system integrator earlier. And the first pitch that we used to give customers was, rather than spending 10 lakhs in buying a server, you can spend 5,000 rupees per month and run a server for as long as you want. But what happens after that is each time you upgrade, each time something changes, at the end of maybe 3 years, you would have actually spent more on cloud. So the primary reason for moving to cloud has now shifted.
Yeah.
You can't come out also.
Yeah.
So the primary reason for moving to cloud has changed from cost to actually being a more scalable environment as such for need basis. So how many, there are organizations that do hybrid cloud for scale. For example, when an organization like Flipkart conducts a big billion day sale, that is the only time that they need that extensive amount of compute, which means they will use data centers to scale within the cloud environment or to multiple clouds for redundancy. So stuff like that has actually changed the paradigm of looking for cloud as a cost saving measure and moving away, moving towards being a business process enabling measure.
Yeah.
So I guess that's a takeaway.
Yeah, but the locking with a one provider is also a very important concern because coming out of that becomes difficult in most of the cases, at least with some of the larger applications. It may not be that easy to come out of the particular service and move that service to other providers.
And I think it's more prevalent when you look at a SaaS solution, for example.
Yeah.
If you're using a Salesforce or a solution like that, moving your data from that SaaS application to any other SaaS application is very, very difficult.
Yeah.
So with respect to public cloud, multi-cloud addresses a lot of these concerns. And as long as you ensure proper portability of applications between the multiple cloud environments, I think you should be set. But we'll take the discussion forward there. Data sovereignty and control came sixth with 46%. I don't know why it was so low. I think in case I asked the same audience and the audience was, let's say, a banking industry in India, then the answer would have been totally different. Yep. Correct, it is. So this is only the top three. That's the reason. It's there down south. The number of respondents for data integrity was much lower than all of this. It's a very, very important concern, and you need to make sure that you have the necessary security controls built in to make sure that that is not compromised. Moving on, the operational challenges. How many of you manage cloud environments today? Maybe a couple, right? So if I ask you with respect to what are your operational challenges, so as far when we did a survey some time ago, these were the issues that we saw over the last 1 year, which people like you who are managing clouds brought out. Visibility into infrastructure and security. The same thing that was affecting security, a security control as such, visibility was a very, very major concern. The moment you move off workloads to cloud, people were not sure of what data was moving to cloud, what was being copied from here to there. None of that was visible. Compliance, the moment you move off data to cloud and you're serving customers, there are a huge number of compliance and audit measures that you need to have in place. And you need to be able to provide reports for being compliant to that specific standard. Setting consistent security policies. We've all been used to providing security at the perimeter for any of your users accessing the internet. We've all been used to providing security for your data center for all the services that your end customers are using. But suddenly, what is happening is your infrastructure that is serving customers is moving from your on-premise data center to a multiple cloud environment, which means you need to ensure that the security policies that you configure in both these places is exactly the same. And if you have different controls in different places, let's assume you use one firewall in front of your physical data center, and you use a totally different firewall on the cloud. It means any change that you bring has to be made on both simultaneously. And in all probability, the configuration that you need to do on both these security devices is totally different. And there's no way you will achieve consistency. So the moment you have multiple such siloed environments, if you have siloed security running there and siloed type of infrastructure operations, it becomes very difficult to manage. And last and final, because of the pace of movement to cloud, and the number of changes that are executed on the cloud, it becomes very difficult for security to keep pace. Every single service that is deployed on cloud in most probability will not have the necessary security controls in front for protection. So these are the challenges that we at Palo Alto Networks saw, and these are the challenges that you will face when you start moving to cloud. And do we have solutions for all of this? We do. So fundamentally, differences between a legacy application and a cloud-native application, there is a lot of middleware that is involved in a cloud, in a legacy application. It is designed, developed most probably in-house and runs out of a data center. But in contrast, cloud itself changes the entire way in which an application or a solution is delivered to the enterprise. For one, your release cycles are much shorter. Two, it is optimized for running in multiple cloud environments. It is hardware agnostic. Microservices, somebody was talking about it, where you need to provide additional security to segment the services that you're providing at the most granular level possible. And rather than having a test and development and operations environment separately, we're suddenly seeing DevOps and SecDevOps, all of it working together for optimization. So because of this, the requirements for security itself has changed. And securing cloud, trust me, is hard. And most of us, most of the customers that I've spoken to over the last 6 months, they are on various stages of their journey to cloud. And while the discussion is clear as to, yes, they need to move to cloud, their understanding of what needs to be done to secure their move to cloud is very, very dicey. Most of them try to do a forklift upgrade or a forklift move from whatever security infrastructure they have on-premise and then move that to cloud and hope it works. And they have no visibility otherwise other than that. And because of the multiple services that are involved in bringing up your cloud infrastructure, actually giving you full visibility and protection becomes even more challenging. And every discussion has thrown up a new facet of that. Manual security, the moment you move to cloud, suddenly it's very difficult because you have multiple SaaS applications. Today, let's assume you use Office 365, let's assume you use Salesforce, and you use Box. The security controls that you need to do for each of these reside separately. And you need to have separate administrators to manage all of this. And you need to have separate audit and controls, which makes it very difficult for you to get your full security posture. And last and most importantly, human error. A network engineer or a security engineer that you have employed within your organization, I'm sure most of you are either have employed security engineers or are security engineers yourselves, they are used to an ACL that is created on a firewall. They are used to maybe blocking ports and protocols. They are used to firewall configurations and IPS configurations. Suddenly, when you move to public cloud, all of that becomes inconsequential. It is very difficult for me as a security engineer to configure AWS if I don't know AWS. And AWS is not just protecting your perimeter using a firewall. There are additional facets of the infrastructure that is open for breach. So, and because of all of that, the number of human errors that we've seen compromising data is extremely hard. Yeah. It's extremely high.
And
so
then,
which means?
And then there are some other issues as well. Like, for example, you start an instance, and most of the time development community starts an instance, and they forget to even close those instances. So those kind of errors remain quite significantly in the cloud environment.
Correct. And that also leads to cost overruns.
Yeah.
You run a M4X large server on AWS for like 6 months, half your operating expenses go up. And that, once again, results in security challenges also. And that is a human error. That's exactly what Sir was talking about. So all of you in sync with what I've been talking so far? All good? Yep. What do we need? So now I've told you what is wrong and how difficult it is to secure cloud. The need for cloud protection is advanced application and data breach prevention, which means that irrespective of the applications that you use in your move to cloud, and irrespective of where your data goes, we should be able to protect your data, and you should be able to look at what applications are being accessed on cloud, correct? So which means if you have 10 SaaS applications that you're using, all the 10 SaaS applications must be governed, controlled, and secured using a common infrastructure, which is why solutions that are siloed to that specific cloud, like a public, like let's say an AWS or an Azure, will become a little inconsequential in the overall run. Because these security providers or providers like us need to encompass the entire spectrum of cloud services that are offered today. Second one, consistent protection across locations in cloud. Any organization today wants flexibility. Any organization wants to
bring services to the market in 1 day, 1 week, 1 month. Because if you are 2 months late, there is somebody else who's taken your place, which means your time to service is actually much lower than it was before. And because of that, your workloads itself are changing. In contrast to 5 years ago, the number of people who are a roaming workforce is much higher now. And the roaming workforce, if you look at it today, the type of applications they access are also different. I still remember a time when, although I was on the move, I still used to access data that was within my data center only. I used to VPN into my private data center and access applications that were there within my data center. Today, it's not like that. Your roaming user will access Office 365 directly. He is going to access a SaaS application of his choice. He might upload a confidential document onto a storage system that is not supported by your enterprise. For example, if you use Box and he uses Dropbox to upload a confidential document, you have no visibility. So, which means that the protection that any security solution or that you look for should be able to enforce protection across locations and across cloud. And last and most importantly, frictionless in deployment and management. The moment you talk cloud, the biggest advantage of cloud has been the ease of setting it up. I've set up an AWS account for myself and an Azure account for myself for doing testing and stuff. It takes 15 minutes to set it up, and a server is up within 20 minutes with an operating system, and middle layer, and a web-facing infrastructure. It was not possible to do that earlier. If I tell you that to deploy a security solution, you need to do 10 different things and change your network architecture, it will not work. Correct? Any security that is deployed for cloud has to be as seamless as the cloud deployment itself. If you can spin up a server in 5 minutes, you must be able to secure your application in 10 minutes, not more. And it should be as automated as possible. So these are the fundamental requirements of a cloud security solution. Any other requirements that you guys see?
Please.
Yes.
Yeah, so I think the governance part is also one of the key when we are talking about moving to cloud migration, because the way traditionally we have been doing in the enterprise IT, when we move to the cloud, I think the way the people or the roles and responsibilities get defined is one of the key thing when we talk about the cloud.
A governance layer on top of all cloud,
yeah,
correct?
Yeah. Right.
Yeah. Yes.
So, but the fundamental, so the things that is required for the governance comes from this, right? So for example, one of the important part of the ensuring governance is ki all the breaches or instances are getting addressed. So if you have the security architecture in a such a way that it probably looks at all possible breaches, and then probably that will feed the governance requirement, right? So some of those requirements will be on the top of this thing, which will be derived out of this one. But these are some of the fundamental capabilities that will be required to ensure that you are protected in a cloud environment.
Yeah, so the point which I'm trying to make is that when we are, it's not that it's only cloud or completely on-prem. So when the large organizations are moving towards the cloud, it will be kind of always going to be a hybrid model where you have still traditional IT and as well as you are moving towards the cloud.
Yeah.
So I think the approach has to take care that.
So that's what the point number two, right? So it's about consistent protection and across locations and different types of the cloud.
So, so the approach has to be there where a single security platform can cater to both the requirements, because the approach towards cloud will be different from the when we are doing for the traditional IT.
Exactly.
Yeah. Yeah.
So that is, I guess. I can, in case I add a line under that saying and governance, I think it makes sense, correct?
Yeah.
Consistent protection and governance.
But I want to really reflect on the last point. And then we all had been talking about digitization, innovation, right? And this digital innovation is basically talking about even doing so many things. For example, one of the important things that we'll be discussing tomorrow is the speed and volume of the product development and application development that is going into. So for example, for the lot of those kind of new innovative plan, people had been developing applications seamlessly, not only in-house and outside of the organization as well, and they have been integrating it. So they have been opening up their infrastructure for a lot of those third-party interfaces. They have been bringing a lot of those third-party players into the infrastructure. lot of new devices had been now getting integrated into the organizational ecosystem. So a lot of those possibilities of innovation and digitization requires you to with the entire the infrastructure management and application management becomes such a complex, such a scalable, and such a velocity game now. So that is why the deployment should be frictionless. That's why the management of those very diverse, scalable, complex kind of application ecosystem becomes an important part.
Yeah, and if security always follows, then it becomes a problem.
Yeah.
Security has to be at the pace of your development.
Yeah.
So that's very, very, very important, because we've seen that if there is an incident where there is a breach, there is a chance that half an hour can actually do a lot of brand damage. So which means that unless you involve security into your development operation, so that's why it's now called SecDevOps, there is no way in which you'll be able to deliver consistent security to the applications that you design for both your end users and your customers. So I'm now shifting gears. Now the first section that I'll cover is SaaS security and our approach to SaaS security. So from SaaS security or for any security for any software as a service, these are the three primary facets of what any security solution should cover. Once again, I'm not talking about our product here. This is our approach to the product, and this is what we would want our customers also to agree to. In case you don't, please let us know. For example, this is one example that I just told you a minute ago. Your organization allows file storage on Box, but your employees use Dropbox, which means it is uncontrolled SaaS usage. You use Office 365, but your employees upload and download attachments via Gmail, uncontrolled SaaS usage. This is called shadow IT. This was a term that was used some time ago also. But this is something that a lot of organizations need to do a lot of work to control. We do run something called a security lifecycle review in customer places as a first line of engagement to customers like you. And what we've seen is in most places, there is a lot of shadow IT, which the IT department itself is not aware of. And clamping down on shadow IT and restricting uncontrolled SaaS usage goes a long way in improving the overall security posture that you have. Second, exposure of sensitive data. Earlier, all the data was there within your data center. All you need to do was put in DLP, make sure that there is a network level DLP to block exits from your environment, and an endpoint level DLP. Suddenly, what is happening is all this data has gone to cloud, which means the same amount of DLP that you have on your endpoint on your network, that level of DLP has to be there on the SaaS application that you use. And you should be able to fine-tune it to meet your organization's demands. A SaaS application like a Box or an Office 365 will give you DLP solutions. But if you decide to deploy separate exposure solutions for each of the SaaS applications you use, it will become a never-ending story. So the security solution that you use must be able to provide you a single window to provide you with full details of the exposure of all your sensitive data across all the SaaS applications that you use. And third and most importantly, around 6 of the last 8 major breaches that we saw in the last 1 year involved the spread of malware through SaaS applications themselves. Which means that earlier, network perimeter trying to hit your servers, today it's easier for me to infect a Box storage because you might not have the required security controls there. And in case I have a document file that is malicious uploaded onto your Box storage, it becomes easier for your people to download it and get infected themselves. So these are the three primary facets of SaaS security that any organization should look at as far as we are concerned. Any other inputs from your side, I'd open up for your inputs.
Yeah, means I think apart from these three, if anything that you would like to add to the list actually.
Anything? So all of you are in agreement with what I say? Yes? No? More or less, okay? Fine. Okay. So these are the various approaches that a lot of organizations started taking to SaaS security. One was SaaS native security. This is what some of you mentioned, that the provider itself provides me with security. The problem there was that it was limited scope. If you have 6 different SaaS applications, each of the security facets of that specific SaaS application will look at data within the application only. It means you do not have a consolidated view. Second one, you have CASB vendors. The problem with CASB vendors or cloud access security brokers is that point number one, traditionally they work across only two ports, port 80 and port 443. So your infrastructure will need to forward port 80 and 443 traffic into the CASB cloud, and all the DLP inspection, all of that is done there, and then it moves on to the SaaS environment. So all of you have heard of CASB vendors?
Yeah, there are many.
Yep. So CASB vendors take data to their cloud via some sort of a forwarding mechanism and then send it back to the SaaS vendors cloud. There the problem is two-pronged. One, that you get once again limited visibility because you're looking at only two ports, and two, deployment is a concern, which means that the moment you have roaming users, you require agents to be installed on each of the end users for you to connect, which becomes a very, very big pain for large enterprises. Because the moment you have large enterprises, you'll have roaming users will connect directly to the SaaS cloud. All of them should have agents or pack files sitting on the endpoint to redirect traffic to the CASB provider. And third one was legacy content security. So all these on-prem devices that were doing content analysis, that was a third approach that a lot of organizations took. There, it provided you with extremely limited context. So what is our approach and what we recommend as an approach to SaaS security is this. Remote users, branch users, or people from the headquarters, in case they already have a Palo Alto Networks firewall at the perimeter or somewhere within their line of defense, you'll be able to do one level of protection there. And every sanctioned SaaS application that the organization runs, we will connect over APIs only. So this was exactly what Sir was talking about earlier when you said integration between providers, which means you open up your APIs and open up it.
So entire ecosystem is now going more open banking or open architecture way, right? For example, we usually talk about GDPR, but we really don't really talk about PSD2. Anybody know about PSD2? What is that? Payment Services Directive 2. So it is probably a little bit different than what GDPR is. So Payment Services Directive 2 of the European Union talks about breaking the monopoly of the banking environment over the banking data or financial data. So it's like it is a compulsory mandatory requirement where they have to make that data open to the third party providers or fintech innovation providers. So that is how all across the globe, even organizations and the governments are forcing the legacy organization to make their data open for third party innovation. So it's for your intrinsic reason and for the compliance reason, like a PSD2, you need to make your data open. So that's the open architecture ecosystem. Because of your own requirement and because of the external force of the government or regulators had been now coming in. And in that case, you need to be increasingly open to the external world.
So we use the same open structure that each of your sanctioned SaaS providers use and then connect back onto it via APIs to do all that I told you earlier in my previous slide, which is this. Your infrastructure does not change at all. And third, you can do it for any SaaS application that you use. So this is why one specific question in the questionnaire asks you for the number of SaaS applications and the names of the SaaS applications you use. So there is a list of supported SaaS applications that we have today. In case we receive feedback from you with respect to any new SaaS applications that you're using, we work back with our engineering to make sure we will be able to serve it better. Does that make sense? You needn't even tell me which organization you belong to. So this is what we are doing now. In cloud activity and protect data, we protect it via APIs by connecting in the backend, which means there is no additional configuration that is needed except an API level connect between your SaaS application and the security suite. Moving forward.
Just one step back. So how you bring context of individual organization to this one? So yes, you are talking to Dropbox or any other third party SaaS application. So how you build the context of individual organization into that one? So what exactly that mechanism is?
So what happens is, as an organization, let's assume you subscribe to the service, your organization's SaaS administrator privileges will be used to connect our API, our solution, to the SaaS application you choose, which basically means full context of what data your accounts are using, we will have visibility to.
Okay. And then your identities and all of those things.
All of that. So we can understand who is storing what, whether any data is moving out to untrusted users, whether there is any malware that is moving across your organization, what levels, in case there is any confidential data that is being uploaded or downloaded, whether any data is moving out to a third party organization which is not trusted by your organization, all of that in the back end only, which makes it extremely simple for us. I actually had a demo of this, but I think we are a little short of time.
Another question is this Enhance, you written something on Enhance. So what is Enhance? Like?
So Enhance is basically, so earlier, so if you look at it in hindsight, traditional firewalls used to send very little logs.
Yeah.
Which meant that if you look at a firewall log maybe 8 or 10 years ago, you would have IP address, port, source and destination. That's it, nothing else. When we came into the picture with the next generation firewall, we added application context to that, which allows you to say, okay, this end user is accessing this application and he is headed out to this part of the world or accessing this specific infrastructure. All of this in one log. But this was insufficient, especially when you have uncontrolled SaaS usage. So an organization should be able to mark saying these are the 10 SaaS applications that I have allowed. And that is the additional context that we provide for SaaS applications.
Without take a particular decision of security, you need a lot of those enrichment.
Correct.
A lot of those understanding about the context. So announcement is basically providing the context to take the security decision, right?
Correct. As a specific organization.
Yeah.
So if an organization wants to track their uncontrolled SaaS usage or to restrict it, you can do it with a click of a button.
Yeah.
And that context or log is available for you to take action also in the future.
Yeah. Hope this is understood.
It's clear? Making sense? Am I? Yes, ma'am.
That that the people do not access, say, their personal Google Drive where it is allowed, rather than a company drive?
Yes, this is.
Okay.
All right. So I had a slide for that. So this is exactly what I meant when I said, one, you need to understand your shadow IT usage, how many applications are running within your organization which are not allowed by your organization. Reveal data exposures within sanctioned SaaS. So which means any SaaS application that you are using, you should have one view. And the view should look like this. It's not there. Which basically says, okay, I have 15 cloud applications and intellectual property or confidential information, I have seen 15 times or 20 times across these 10 apps. Mm-hmm. You should be able to take corrective action and remediation on that immediately. And you should be able to quarantine such files and restrict access immediately if needed. So that level of visibility to all the SaaS applications in one window, that is what your SaaS security suite should look like. Agree with me? Sounds okay? All right. Yes, ma'am.
See, the entire approach and the solution that you are showing here is pretty much revolving around the Palo Alto networks, right? So let's take okay, the clients where we do not have a Palo Alto network, and how is your Apache solution, works in that scenario?
So for SaaS security, specifically you're talking about our SaaS security solution, right? Our SaaS security solution does not require or mandate you to use a firewall at the perimeter in any way, because the backend connection that I told you does not rely on the firewall. It is only a service that you subscribe from us. So in case you want SaaS security, that is one component of our platform that you buy. You're not mandated to buy the firewall. The firewall only provides you with understanding of the shadow IT usage, one part of it. Because we need to be somewhere within your network to find out what other applications you're using. For all your sanctioned SaaS applications, you don't need the firewall.
Okay.
Yes. So let's assume you have Office 365, for example, and OneDrive. So your OneDrive administrator will use his username and password to connect to my security instance, and then we will have full visibility into your data. And then we'll tell you whether there is any untrusted sharing happening, whether there is any malware download that's happening, any malicious files that are uploaded. In case you need to quarantine all of them, we'll do the quarantine.
And if you have the Palo Alto firewall, that will enrich.
Correct. This part, so like I said, the moment you start looking at security in silos, security is lost, which is why this part of it, understand shadow IT and usage, is what the firewall
does. Suppose you have somebody else firewall there, So can you also talk to that firewall, this particular service?
We have a work, we are headed in that direction, and I'll tell you how we are, and there is a way to do it today.
Yeah.
So for example, in case you have information with respect to specific campaigns or specific logs that you've generated, you can use those logs to create action items on your firewalls also. I'll cover that. Exactly. We understand that. And I'll spend 5 minutes on that to tell you where our vision for security leads, and I hope that will actually add value to what you were just saying. Anything else, ma'am?
So you have introduced one extra layer in the entire network traffic. So what are the performance implications of this? Because I see that you're doing a lot of monitoring, you're directing requests, and how do you then manage or comply to the performance implications of this entire thing? Because this is one additional step that has been introduced.
So from a network standpoint, which means latency introduction standpoint, we assume that you already have a next generation firewall.
Yes.
If you don't have it, it's okay. We are not asking you to add another layer. Either you replace it or you can continue using the same existing firewall that you're using. The solution that we are adding for SaaS security does not have any latency concerns whatsoever, because there is no direct presence in the flow of network traffic at all. It is only like what ma'am was saying earlier, it is only a back-end connect. The moment you store your data, we will look at the data. We do not come in the path of flow at all.
Yeah, but after the event kind of reporting is what you are saying.
Yeah, so
correct.
So I think let me praise this one. So if it is only for purpose of providing visibility, but if you are really using that visibility to take action, right? So the action is now you will be entering into terms of managing or taking those decisions actually. So in that case, would that be leading
even
to
then for SaaS, we don't sit in line at all. Okay. Our approach has not been to sit in line for your sanctioned SaaS applications. The reason is, it's like I told you earlier, it is very difficult to deploy a inline solution for your SaaS applications because it's extremely complex. And any organization that, for us, it's near real time. The moment you upload a file, we analyze the file, find out if there is any leakage or DLP, any policy violation or malware propagation, and then allow you to quarantine the file immediately. Because SaaS storage is data at rest.
Yeah.
And it is data at rest that we are monitoring, not network
so
data.
In typical security architectural discussion in terms of managing the or taking the decision, security decision, usually it's a PDP, right? Policy definition point and policy enforcement point. So what we are basically talking about is how exactly those policy definitions come from all of this context which is building from this particular service.
Okay.
If you are enforcing on the network, enforcing with the firewall or any IDS or IPS kind of solution, then that will learn from this particular policy
correct
definition points and take those action at a ground level. And that is where actually some latency problem
that
may
latency
come.
Will come in. That latency will anyway come.
Yeah.
It is a detect and remediate mechanism for your data at rest on public cloud. And it's an approach that we are slightly different from our regular approach, which means prevention first, inline, block always type of an approach, because we could have gone both ways. We could have gone the CASB model where we introduce one layer, add the latency, ask you to do a lot of configuration changes. But then we realized what a lot of organizations wanted was first visibility.
Yeah.
And then the ability to do quarantining or do actions after they have the visibility.
Yeah,
because sitting in line,
that's the problem of CASB solution, because it really limits the possibilities of the innovation and those interaction and interfaces that you'll have. Whereas this approach is probably first learn first, create a visibility, and then learn from the visibility to take those decisions rather than initially block. So the need to know basis block or by default blocking, which is a firewall or network security culture, is getting changed in these architectural principles actually.
We've also added the ability to reroute traffic for unmanaged devices. So let's assume you have managed devices, you'll be able to push all traffic through firewalls for policy enforcement. For unmanaged devices also, we do SAML authentication by redirection to the firewall, for making sure that all traffic goes via the firewall. That's a new feature, but I don't think it makes sense for us to discuss that today. This is the list of SaaS applications that we've supported for quite some time now. I'd like you to take a look at it for a minute and let us know if there is any key application that is not covered here. Box, Citrix ShareFile, Confluence, Dropbox, GitHub, Gmail, Google, Jive, Microsoft Exchange, Office 365, Salesforce, Secure Data Space, ServiceNow, Slack, Azure, Yammer, Amazon Web Services, G Suite, S3, Workplace, and Google Cloud Storage. Any other applications, SaaS applications you're using? Salesforce is also there. Ah, it's there, yes. Any other applications, SaaS applications you guys are using? Majorly? No? Yes? This is the current list as of now. So in case you can give us details of what you're using. We can.
SAP.
Okay.
Generally, ERP is like the Oracle, Ramco's.
And SAP.
No, it's still not there. It's still not there. All right?
And which are difficult out of this one for you to really deploy the solutions? Like,
see, it depends upon how much the provider opens up to us.
Yeah.
We've had Box, Dropbox, and Jive for quite some time, which means the integration is pretty much seamless. Yeah. The new ones take a little time.
Yeah.
But because it's all backend, it doesn't involve in the flow of traffic and does not affect all our inflow.
These applications are also opening up for
yes.
Engaging with the security providers and providing those kind of abilities
correct.
To integrate, right?
Yes. And the reason for that is we at Palo Alto Networks, you'll see that in a slide that comes up maybe in 10 minutes from now, we do not believe that we will be able to solve all your security problems. That's a very bold statement for us to make. Because usually we as security OEMs, we go to customers, we've been going to customers, and we tell them, come to us, we'll solve your security problems. But we've realized of late, especially over the last 1 year, that it's very difficult to do that. Because every 3 months, 4 months, like what ma'am was saying sometime earlier, you get new providers. You get somebody who's doing something totally new. And you need to be able to consume that intelligence in a manner that is extremely simple for you. And that is where security is a challenge today. And what we've done is that we've allowed any third-party security OEM to write applications for us on something that we call the application framework. I'll cover that in a couple of minutes. Maybe I hope that it will pave the way for a much more secure, simple security ecosystem going forward.
Yeah, and then those are key part of the platformization of security.
Correct.
Actually. So how you enable the entire ecosystem to work on the platform that you lay down. Yeah.
Yeah, since I'm actually running a little short of time, we're already 55 minutes into this. I'll cut short the demo
yeah.
and I'll move forward. Moving on to public cloud security. All of you are on public cloud? Yes, no? Let's have some action in the house, please. Yes? Yes. Traditionally, what happens on public cloud is we do this, which is basically inline protection, correct? So you have your public cloud workload, which can be an AWS, can be an Azure, can be a Google Cloud, and you put a firewall in front of that VPC or that VNet or whatever you call it, and then say my cloud infrastructure is secure. But that is grossly insufficient. And that is grossly insufficient when you have changing cloud workloads that are moving to cloud. What we usually ignore are two facets of cloud security. Inline part, yes. The second one is the monitoring and compliance part. So you have standard compliances that you need to be in place for every single cloud provider that you use. So it can be a HIPAA compliance, it can be PCI compliance, it can be SOC 2 compliance, it can be NIST. All of this, you need to have your cloud infrastructure also compliant to all of this. But your firewall that is sitting in front has no way or will not provide you any sort of understanding of what compliance level you are in. This is something that is overlooked by a lot of people. How many of you have a continuous security and compliance measure that is there on your public cloud infra today? Out of maybe six customers that I've spoken to, one of them had. Very, very few people have. And every time that we speak to them, this is a major area of concern. And third is the host security within cloud. So when somebody was asking about how do we make sure that when you move to cloud and I start using open source workloads, how do I secure that? In all probability, you're not using Windows machines on cloud. You'll start using Linux. And when you use Linux, if you look at the number of exploits that have been released on Linux for the last 6 months, they actually come close to what is there on Windows. Because as more and more workloads move to cloud, paying Microsoft for the Microsoft licensing, people don't usually want to go there. They'll go the RHEL way. And when you go with Linux, you traditionally assume that it's secure, and you might not have an AV protecting it. And AV, by default, is dead. So which is a conundrum. It's like a chicken and egg story. In case I go with Microsoft, I have to pay. Then I have to buy AV. AV is dead. So now what do? I go with Linux. Linux, is it secure? You assume it is. But then it's not. So that cycle keeps repeating itself, and your host level security is also compromised. So in order to look at that, what we propose to customers is, one, irrespective of what firewall you use, I would prefer that you use Palo Alto Networks, add a firewall in front of each of your public cloud workloads. And make sure that that firewall is application aware, is integrated with your Active Directory or whatever directory services you use, and provides user, application, and contextual data into whatever data is moving up and down your cloud. Okay? So inline security, these are the problems that inline security solution for cloud solves. Any internet-facing application, a hybrid cloud environment. So let's assume in this era where an AWS is competing with a Microsoft to deliver better services, you might have workloads that are split between the two. You might have you might do high availability between an AWS and an Azure, which means you need to have a consolidated security policy between these two. So which means, once again, you need to have the same firewall in front. And you should have a central management for both the firewalls. So which means that if an application changes behavior and you need to open a specific port, or you need to allow access to a specific user on the Azure cloud, you don't have to touch three places, which is your on-premise firewall, your Azure firewall, and an AWS firewall. You touch only the management console that is creating policies for all three. It actually simplifies the overall mechanism of setting it up. So for internet-facing applications, for hybrid clouds, for east-west traffic between VPCs, and for outbound traffic, this is a solution that any inline solution for your public cloud infrastructure will be able to solve. And there are additional metrics that you can use. I'll not get into that. This is the journey that we've had with cloud for quite some years now. So this is basically so if you look at it here, this is once again platformization. This is once again going the way of ensuring that you will be able to consume services from any of these providers and integrate it well with your infrastructure. So Google was, how many of you started evaluating Google Cloud? This is an honest question, because most customers that I've spoken to are saying, yes, Google is there, but we still aren't seeing too much of them. Google Cloud? No? You've started working with them?
Yeah.
Oh, great. So how easy do you think it is? Better than AWS? Okay. Fine. Anybody else with Google or evaluating Google currently? Oh, you are? Okay.
Those are the options which Google Cloud is giving. And
so the go-to-market defines the strategy of, okay, looking.
And then primarily SMB customer, they are getting influenced because of the Google.
Oh, okay.
Google has very specific offerings for SMB customer, actually.
Okay. All right. So what we do for management, security management, this is irrespective of whether you're doing it in cloud, on-premise, or wherever. The management console for all of this remains the same. So if you have a security policy that is defined for a specific application, that policy will remain the same and will be enforced from a single place for all your infrastructures, which is even if it is private cloud, any of the public clouds that you use, or your endpoints, be it wherever, you only have one point to manage. So when you're designing security for a hybrid cloud environment, which can encompass private and public cloud with a mixture of clouds, one of the first questions that you need to answer is, will I be able to manage security for all of this from one single place? If the answer is no, then that is not the security solution to go for. Moving ahead, this is what I was telling you earlier with respect to compliance. One of the major problems that a lot of customers have been facing is the sheer volume of information that AWS and Azure throws at them with respect to compliance, and then making sense of it, and then taking action on it. So in case AWS tells you that your S3 bucket is not secure, then there are 10 things that you need to do. You'll have 50 or 60 different accounts that are there in your organization. For each of those accounts, if you decide to go in and start doing remediation, it takes an army of engineers nearly a day to do it regularly. So which means that compliance is something that is critical and very, very important for any organization to look at.
Yeah, I think I'll just want to take an example. Recently, I don't want to take a name, it's a car connect application, and that it, they end up leaking 5,000 data, 5,000 records of 5,000 users basically. And the basic problem that they realize is that the deployment on the AWS happen on a public facing kind of bucket. And that was the key problem. Because there is no visibility available in terms of where exactly is deployed and understanding the character of that bucket. And because of that, they end up leaking that information.
Correct. Because if you know, AWS S3 buckets are actually URLs that you can access.
Yeah, yeah.
It functions as storage. And most probably, you wouldn't have secured that storage.
Yeah.
Because US security engineers or US security architects or US security administrators, you will not be the person who's configuring that S3 storage. It will be part of your business team. It will be part of your development team. When he configures S3 storage for some of his applications, your data is what is getting stored there and get leaked like whatsoever.
And unfortunately, this is like a your developer application, which is helping you to connect to your car.
Correct.
Such a critical application which was deployed on a S3 bucket actually.
So it becomes life-threatening. So I was talking to one of the CISOs recently who said, until now, security administrators had to deal with compliance and audit related queries. It may be 1 year or 2 years down the line, security practitioners will have to deal with the police and crime.
And then this is a race of digitization, right? So people are really mad in terms of making it connected, making it enabled, making it available to mobile. And this race and this velocity of digitization is making them to deploy and use those kind of resources available and deploy the way they are very basically looking at.
Yeah. How many of you heard of that application that Baba Ramdev launched?
Yeah, that was a great example of all of these things.
I've got a lot of hands up now. He launched an app. Everyone found out that it was problematic and it was communicating over HTTP. So that's the race all of us can get caught into, knowingly or unknowingly. That was a large scale issue that happened. It became extremely popular. But for organizations like ours also, the number of different siloed departments that you have, it becomes very difficult to make sure that security is enforced at every layer. And unless you have audit and compliance measures everywhere, it's very difficult for you to do that. Which is why what we've done is we've actually acquired a company called Evident.io, and we integrated that into a security platform, into the platform that we offer. And what it does is something similar to what I told you earlier, where your SaaS security suite connects over APIs. This connects over APIs to the AWS infrastructure itself and the public-facing cloud infrastructure, which means that every single configuration that you do on public cloud, this application has a visibility into. Which means if you have exposed S3 storage, if your keys are not rotated, if you're using default passwords anywhere, and any such compliance concern or security concern at the configuration layer is something that this application look at and give you guided remediation. Which means you will be able to, it will tell you exactly what you need to do to remediate that issue and make sure that your cloud infrastructure is secure. So something that we've seen is it evaluates approximately 50 plus security best practices for AWS, and there is a report generation directly from the console. And the dashboard is interactive for the SOC team and the security operations team.
So this is primarily instances discovery tool, right?
Correct.
Instances and computation discovery tool.
Full-fledged infrastructure discovery, compliance, and reporting for public cloud environments.
Yeah.
So in case you're considering a move to public cloud or you're already on public cloud, I would urge you to start looking at solutions like this. Because this is usually underreported. People don't usually see the risks that are involved. And only when somebody reaches out to you saying you've been breached and then you figure out that it is like the S3 bucket that Sir told you about, that is when you realize, oh my God, my S3 bucket is open. Okay? So this is once again a demonstration. Do we have time?
We have time, actually. We can go through some one or two demonstrations.
I'll do one demo. I'll not do the other one. Sorry, ma'am, I didn't hear you.
So the application that you have, is there a pin that you have to enter they have to enter their own pin, right?
That will come up on screen.
So you are saying that you will be sharing the pin, or they
will come? I'll show it up on. It will come up on screen. So this is an example of security. I need to sign in twice, and in case I'm not connected to VPN, it'll ask me for a second factor of authentication, irrespective of the application that you use. So all of this is something that you need to start looking at when you're looking at SaaS applications. SaaS applications without MFA, big problem. Because what we've seen is approximately 60% of the largest breaches that happened in the world last year was because of stolen credentials. So if you have credentials within your organization that are leaked out in any manner, they can be used to gain access into your environment.
But SaaS applications are now creating good kind of a demand for two-factor authentication. Actually.
Correct. So enforcement is key.
Yeah.
So this is basically what it looks like. For example, you have separate teams, and you'll be able to identify specifically what the risks that are identified within the last 24 hours with respect to each of the public cloud applications that you're using. For example, so here, I click on details. So if you look at it here, you can define each individual team in your organization and map it to an account saying, this is the account, and this is the account that I need to scan for these 25 or these 50 different types of compliances and these type of risks. And what you will be able to see is that it will tell you specifically storage accounts encryption in transit. To ensure the security of your Azure storage data, ESP recommends that you encrypt data between client and Azure storage. So this is shows up as an alert. For you to see this within your Azure or AWS instance itself will take time. And for you to create a remedy for that, that takes even more time. So what it gives you clearly the remediation steps that are needed for that specific alert that you've seen. And with AWS, what we can do today is integrate with SNS and Lambda to automatically trigger a remediation. So in case you feel that you want to trigger a remediation, you want to make that change, the moment an alert comes up, let's say saying that you have an S3 storage with a default username and password, or it is exposed to the internet, I can have that alert trigger an SNS, and from SNS, a script can be triggered on Lambda for you to close that gap. All of this can happen automatically. So it's left to your imagination and AWS's backend infrastructure with respect to how
Somebody has asked the question about during the operation, if instance comes, how quickly it can really close the equipment. So these are probably the ways. Yeah.
To a certain extent, automation of new workloads coming up, ensuring compliance, and in the event of there being a deviation in compliance, using AWS native services itself to remediate that. Making sense?
So this service of event.io, so how exactly it got information about teams? Is it talking to the firewall or?
There's no firewall involved at all here.
Okay.
So what you do is, AWS allows you to connect specific security services with the key exchange.
Okay.
So the key exchange happens between the two, and the connection is direct.
Okay.
There's no firewall at all involved.
Okay. All the configuration of AWS, you can build the context of that, and based on that, you can create.
And what is extremely very nice about this overall setup is that I will be able to pull out compliance data for all the configuration that is needed. For example, this is the Azure Network Security Group, AWS Security Group Fitness. For example, SSH port detected. On port 22, how many accounts have opened port 22 for your external facing infrastructure? This is a compliance issue because traditionally, for infrastructure that is hosted on AWS and Azure, you do not need to open port 22. Usually, it is port 80 and 443. One single click gives you how many accounts are affected because of this. And it gives me specifically these are the accounts.
Yeah, and this network security group, so these are some of the communities, right? So they come up with the possible type of the issues and problem that may happen. And that probably becomes a standard. And based on the standard, you can think about the pattern and identify the issue.
Correct.
And there are a lot of those communities which are coming into the picture. And they have been trying to define lot of those kind of standards to and help you to identify the possible issues in a particular pattern.
Exactly. So, this is the AWS Foundation benchmark, CIS. Yeah.
So this understanding continues. Of this kind of work that different communities, different organizations have been doing is also a very interesting part for us to really build our capability in this area. Because that is how the technical ability for us to understand what goes wrong in terms of the traffic level situation also improves. And some Indian people are also contributing to this kind of standard actually.
So PCI DSS, how many of you have PCI DSS as part of your compliance framework? Most of you? So your cloud workloads, with one click, it will give you exactly how many instances or accounts within your cloud infrastructure are allowed. Do not use vendor supply defaults or system passwords and other security parameters. So we know specifically that usually your username and password is admin.
Yeah. Or so this is very very interesting actually paradigm which is coming. So until now, we probably knew the compliance requirement. But contextualizing those individual compliance requirements particularly to exact infrastructure, exact configuration was a really challenge until now. But that gap is getting closed increasingly because of this kind of approach that people are implementing. So otherwise, what compliance requirement talks about and what we are implementing, there used to be a huge gap. But a particular compliance requirement, say in a PCI DSS, how it applies to a particular infrastructure piece or particular traffic session is also something that is very important. And probably that gap is increasingly closed because of this kind of initiative which is happening. And platformization allows you, basically, to make this possible.
So the moment you have a security solution that covers all of this for all the environments that you use, that is when true platformization is achieved. So, for example, HIPAA, one single report that covers all your clouds and tells you exactly where you're deviating and then allows you to do the remediation from there directly. So all of this is available directly, and like I told you, there is a clear dashboard.
Yes. You and did. Historically, we had been doing this compliance check on Excel sheet, but now it has come to very much technical level.
We do it for AWS, Azure. Google Cloud is currently under development, but the capabilities are higher on AWS than on Azure.
Is it because these native cloud providers,
correct,
they are also maturing in terms of what they need to throw information for somebody to understand security or issue and identify any event or any kind of incident. So they are also maturing from their side. That's why we are able to really look at.
Correct. So if you look at it, there are exactly like what you said. Each of these providers has been in the market for a different period of time.
Yeah.
The maturity of an AWS, Azure is getting there, but it's not yet there. And the amount of third-party integrations that AWS has, Azure still does not have.
Yeah.
So that is the reason for the difference in the number of compliance rules and signatures that we support. But that being said, Azure will mature. And to be honest, the reason why we support more for AWS is that Evident.io, when we acquired them and then brought them to the platform, they were more on AWS than on Azure.
Yeah.
So we now call that the security platform now.
Yeah, and then that is very, we will learn that tomorrow, actually, when you talk about platform. So that also needs to be defined. So one of the important definition of the platform and component of definition of the platform is experience of people get uploaded to the global experiences, right? So for example, you subscribe to this service, so your being on this particular service helps other because your experience is getting uploaded there, and other being on that platform helps you. So it's you are leveraging from the experiences of others and you are contributing with your experiences. So all those experiences are getting together as a platform. And that is why the ability to work, ability to identify problem, and even possibility of innovation is significantly improved with the platformization. And that is how entire technology direction is also moving, and security is also catching up the platformization journey quite significantly. I think there are seats here.
Oops.
So does that make sense to you overall with respect to how you look at public cloud and how one, a firewall or a security solution in front, in line will help you protect your data moving in and out of the cloud, and how a compliance solution is required and mandatory for you to ensure that you configure your cloud correctly. Because cloud configurations are not a security guy's job today. It is usually DevOps, it is usually the guy who configures a workload. Yeah. And there is no way he will take security clearance. How many of you have an established security clearance process before your workload moves to cloud? Very few of us have that. And when we talk with customers, some of them give us this information that cloud as of now is hazy, but whenever somebody comes to us with a cloud environment, we ask him to create his own account and set up his own infrastructure on cloud.
Yeah, even you have gated approach for the security verification or security authorization for moving to cloud, that will not work.
It will not.
Because it's such a elastic, such a open, anybody can easily open account there. And that's what all the development side people have been accusing, because they go ahead and do all of those kind of, they go ahead and open those instances. But probably rather than constraining them in terms of kicking up those activity, it's better to look at what basically they are doing and understand that, get a visibility over that, and then probably look at what you need to do in terms of security.
Exactly. That's something that is key, and that's something that should drive your discussions going forward. And that is why a couple of questions that we have in the questionnaire are specifically directed against how often do you make changes in your cloud workloads. So that is once again for us to understand how dynamic your cloud environment is and how solutions can be better tailored. For example, now the scanning frequency for cloud applications or cloud public cloud workloads is 5 minutes. In case you have workloads going continuously, then we need to shorten that. So that's the reason why questions like that are in the questionnaire. Yeah, so we've covered this. And finally, as far as cloud is concerned, you've covered the compliance part for the configuration. You've covered the inline security part with a firewall or a security. You might have a firewall, an IPS, a URL filtering solution, all of that in front. What you will still need to secure is your virtual servers that are residing on the cloud. And when you move away from a regular Windows environment, it becomes even more difficult to manage, which is why, one, traditional AV and HIPS focus on signatures cannot protect from attacks. So when you're on cloud, if you can try this yourself. If you turn up a VM, a server, on a AWS VPC and open it for internet access, within 15 minutes, you will see at least 60 attacks or 70 attacks. They can be brute force attacks. They can be direct access requests, but you will see. And if you configure your default username and password on any of the infrastructure that you host, within half an hour, that infrastructure will be broken. In private cloud or in your own data center, the chances for that are extremely low. The reason for, because of all of this is open, traditional AV and HIPS cannot protect your infrastructure servers within the cloud, which is why that should change. And network security cannot prevent zero-day attacks. Once again, we are a network security provider. We've been a network security provider for quite some time now. But we understand that because of the way cloud is architected, point number one, I cannot do decryption for all traffic. Because the traffic that is going to hit your application servers is going to be extremely confidential to you, and us decrypting that can pose privacy questions for you.
Yeah.
In case an encrypted channel is used to deliver malware, then the firewall or any inline security solution will not be able to protect you, which is why you need to have comprehensive security at the endpoint. There are a host of players out there. There are people like Silence, there are people like Carbon Black who provide advanced endpoint security solutions for a diverse set of workloads. We are there, and we are there because we felt that we needed to add on to our network security and cloud security with a position on the endpoint. And that is the reason why, as a cloud service, we've actually launched our endpoint security solution called Traps.
Okay, so until now, in last 1 year, we have all of those EDR solution providers like Silence, Cyberbit, or even CrowdStrike kind of organization. So they primarily looking from the endpoint capabilities, right? And that also is leading to threat hunting kind of operation platform they are creating out of it. So now you are saying that network providers or network security providers also can come into this game.
Yes.
Okay.
And, I'll step out of my shoes from Palo Alto Networks for a couple of minutes and step into a regular security consultant role. If you look at threat intelligence and protecting customer enterprises, what is most important is data, correct? With data in the form of logs. Data in the form of what malware is seen, what good files are seen, what bad files are seen. Correct? 10 years ago, the primary vector for any malicious attack used to be a floppy disk, a USB drive.
Yeah.
Today, that is more or less dead. The primary vector has moved to the network. So when the primary vector moves to the network, network security players see a much more of bad things than what is directly hitting the endpoint, without hitting the endpoint.
Mm-hmm.
Correct? So which means that we have a much more visibility into the bad things that are happening across the world, and it is logical for us to take the step into endpoint.
Okay. But architecturally, I'm just asking question. This endpoint detection response, they target on endpoints, right? And they learn endpoint and they get intelligence from each of the endpoint the way solution has been deployed. And there could be one or two network pieces, but where in case of endpoint, there will be thousands of endpoint they will be deploying their solution. So amount of data they will be collecting will be also comparatively huge as compared to data that you will be collecting from the network. So
yes.
Is that a true assumption?
It is a very, very true assumption.
Yeah.
And that is why I don't want to do the sales talk here. But we've actually added, not only us, and I'm sure that a lot of organizations will follow suit, we've added the capability to do EDR onto our endpoint agent also.
Okay.
So what that means is that where we see the world going is, irrespective of where your data resides, there must be a point to sense one data and two malware or any infection of that sort, or any traffic pattern that is anomalous. For us to detect that, one, there has to be a presence on the network, and two, there has to be a presence on the endpoint.
Yeah.
If I'm able to collect all this information, including the information that you just said, any solution can work on it and provide intelligence to you to maybe thwart attacks and maybe to do proactive prevention. And which means a full-fledged solution that covers network, endpoint, and cloud will be the best way for you to secure your environment. And most security providers are moving in that direction.
So I'll also like to now talk about one thing. So for example, so these services that being taken by one organization, there are multiple organizations taking these services. And there could be a lot of learnings you also have from the security issue that may go with multiple of those organizations. So that will also add into this one, right?
Correct. So threat intel sharing from organizations. For example, what we've been doing for the last maybe 6 or 7 years is, let's assume we detect a threat somewhere in the US or Cuba or wherever. We deliver intelligence for that threat as quickly as 5 minutes to all our customers across the globe. So that intel sharing is something that is going up in a much, much better manner today. There is something called a cyber threat alliance that brings together the brains of the cybersecurity industry, which has likes like McAfee, Fortinet, Cisco, Checkpoint, and us. We were one of the founding members, which brings together all these OEMs also to consolidate the fight against the bad guys. And we also have mechanisms in which we pull back information from other customers and feed it to all the customers across the globe.
So can this then lead to an SLA? You talk about 5 minutes basically. Can some consumer, are you promising that SLA to the consumer that within a span of 5 minutes, we will be able to identify any zero day vulnerability that may be impacting or would be impacting you?
Our signature deliver. So let's assume I detect a threat, I deliver the signature within 5 minutes.
Okay.
That
means any corner of the world, if you detect something, you will deploy that to all of the firewall networks basically. So any consumer in India would also get in.
Would also
minutes.
Get protected.
Okay.
And the faster your responses are against threats, the easier it is to remain secure. That is the reason why we've adopted this. I will not take too much time on the endpoint because we're already at 12:30 and I need 15 minutes for the quiz.
Yeah.
And I don't want you to stop you in lunch. So in case any of you have questions around the endpoint story or endpoint, how we are different, point number one, from a sales angle, but more importantly, where the endpoint security industry itself is moving and how you would need to make sure that your entire endpoint infrastructure is secure against the latest attacks, please reach out to me during the break. We'll discuss in detail.
We have a very intense panel set up for EDR discussion tomorrow.
Oh, great. So then you can participate.
So that is also an opportunity.
So that's an opportunity for you to learn.
Yeah.
And then hit me if I say I've given you bad information.
Yeah.
So I'll move on. So this is the overall structure that we've defined and that we would urge our customers to follow for automating the entire platform. So like I told you, we deliver cloud-delivered security services. Any signature that flows to you has to be as quick as possible. If there is an attack against your infrastructure, let's assume there is a WannaCry attack that was seen somewhere in South Asia. You do not need to come to the security provider and ask us for signatures for deploying in your environment. Your entire infrastructure must be protected by default. So this is one of the key asks that you can take to any of your security providers. Am I protected automatically against any of the new threats that are seen globally? One, cloud-delivered security services, which includes URL filtering, threat prevention, and malware analysis. All of this flows back as signatures to all the parts of your security, which means it can be network, it can be endpoint, and it can be the cloud. And the possibility of automation of all of this using third-party feeds. So what we allow you to do here is, this is something that you were asking me earlier, sir. Is it possible for you as an organization to consume intelligence that you've received from us on other security services or other security solutions? Or is it possible for you to integrate a feed that you've received from other security solutions or intelligence systems onto our platform? That is where not only us, any industry has to head. Which means that today, let's assume that we've detected a set of URLs that are associated with a specific type of attack. I should be able to give you these URLs in the form of a feed. It can be a JSON feed, it can be a Styx or taxi feed, it can be a CSV output in the form of, let's say, a static text file. You should be able to consume that in any way that you see fit. For example, let's assume that you have your endpoint solution which is running, let's say, McAfee. Your McAfee endpoint solution will have a list of hashes that it can proactively blacklist as being bad. Any sample that I have seen as bad, I should be able to automatically give that intelligence of hashes to you, and you should be able to consume it automatically on your existing security intelligence. That is today possible with our platform.
So this is like in a very simple form. This is a multiple agencies and multiple solution and technology provider. Some of them are OEM, some of them are security providers.
Correct.
They come into the ecosystem, and then there is a many-to-many connections. For example, and many-to-many in a way that as a Palo Alto, suppose Palo Alto is a part of that, it leverages from what other people are throwing, right? And also Palo Alto contributes back to the entire threat of other solutions. So it's a every solution, like organization, every technology provider is leveraging from others because they are throwing a lot of those data. And also Palo Alto creates a lot of those data for them to use.
Correct.
So it's a primarily leverage and contribute kind of a simplified way of looking at this one.
The key takeaway from that as an add-on is that it's fully automated.
Yeah.
So the moment you say that you will look at feeds
yeah.
and then filter feeds and manually incorporate yeah. it, it becomes problematic.
Yeah. So the interesting part here is then any solution provider's ability to get that data and use that data to enforce something, because every solution enforces something. WAP will enforce something, right? Firewall will enforce something. So use this data and enforce something, and how quickly it does is basically the automation piece will come.
Exactly.
How granular it does it, basically the automation will come. How granularly, basically take out orchestration of the policies. So it's how specific one small step uses this data and enforce something there is basically the automation piece would come in the picture.
Make sense? I hope this discussion on public cloud and SaaS has been, at least you've taken away something from these two. I hope it has. We'll move on to securing private clouds. There was a lot of interest when we started the discussion because I think a lot of you are already on NSX and ACI. So, from a private cloud infrastructure, anybody using any private cloud infra other than NSX and ACI here? Other than NSX and ACI? No? So, OpenStack? OpenStack is fine. Other than that, no, right? So which means that going forward, our development will also continue on NSX, ACI, and OpenStack. So, the same security that you provide for physical data centers and for network perimeter and the cloud is something that you need to deploy in a private data center within, let's say, virtualized workloads. And what is most important is that in contrast to a cloud environment where the orchestration layer takes care of, let's say, the auto scaling and stuff and the movement of VMs and all of that, in the private data center you are responsible, which means that the security system has to be automated to follow every infrastructure piece that is spun up or moved. So which means that if you are, let's say, adding a web application layer as a separate layer, your security policies for that layer should be automatically provisioned with zero touch from your side. So that is where any security solutions players' abilities and capacities will be evaluated. So as far as we are concerned, you should be able to do application level segmentation, which is to a certain extent what we were discussing earlier also. The ability to create virtual instances of firewalls between segments of your private data center. And the moment you add additional devices or additional servers within each of these layers, making sure that the relevant security policies apply by default.
But in this case, there was a question also on the microservices. Like, so application itself is now segmented into a lot of microservices. So how exactly it will work in microservices?
With respect to microservices also, the same steering capabilities can be used within private cloud environments to make sure that any specific traffic flow within the microservices architecture is also inspected and made sure that there is no malicious connections or connectivity that happens there. So that's
it. Will there be a standardized way, or as somebody who's developing this solution from Palo Alto is studying the how the microservices has been built and so developing something for that one?
So we are, to be frank, we are extremely nascent on the microservices security framework, because the reason for that is the adoption has seen the uptake over the last maybe 4-5 months also. We've actually written to a lot of customers asking them for use cases for microservices and how you're deploying microservices themselves. And currently our integration is limited to establishing the service chaining to make sure that each layer that you want to inspect is secured. For example, we hear of a lot of containerization, a lot of stuff like that is coming up in future. And we have security solutions that rely on the orchestration layer to drive traffic between the layers. That's it as of now. Yeah. But if there are any other use case discussions that we would like to have, please touch base with me offline. We'll get that discussion for you.
Yeah.
Make sense? So this is what we do as far as private cloud is concerned. NFV, once again, critical, because a lot of customers today are looking at network functional virtualization where the VM firewall itself forms part of your overall virtualized function. So this is also something that we are very, very serious about. And we see a lot of customers now adopting SD-WAN. So how many of you are either evaluating or are looking at SD-WAN today? Maybe a couple of you. So the SD-WAN journey itself, there are a lot of discussions that we can do to understand where security has to fit in and then fit in security at that place. So that's just because there are a very few of you, I'll not take that discussion further. The same sort of support is available for Cisco ACI also. We are actually listed on Cisco's website saying that we are an application partner. And full level integration. So what happens in a traditional environment with NSX or ACI is that the moment new workloads are spun up, based on the configuration that you've done on the controller, new firewall instances, new security policies will get added by default. We also have a function called dynamic address groups, which means that you can define a tag on NSX manager saying this is a web server. Okay? And the moment you create a new server with the tag of web server on NSX, a security policy is updated on the firewall saying this server must have all the policies that are attached to web server. So the tag information is shared between the NSX manager and the firewall. So which makes it very easy for you to do simple deployment of new infrastructure within your data center. So you don't need to touch the firewall at all. You just need to define the security group or the tag on the NSX manager or the controller. The tag flow happens automatically. This simplifies the way in which you will create security for your private data center.
But there will be multiple tags, right?
There will be. Based on your layers, there will be multiple tags. But the problem today is, when it comes to security, the moment we go for NSX for automation, for operationalization, for simplification and all that. But when you bring in security, the whole thing becomes complex. And people end up putting siloed.
This is very interesting discussion. So until now, we had been talking about network-centric security or application-centric security. This is like a network security lending its support to the application security, right?
Exactly.
And Cisco application-centric is a very important example of that, and you are building on the top of that.
So making sure that irrespective of where your workloads go, and be it whichever OEM that you integrate with, any security player should be very serious there. And that is why we are also extremely keen to partner with whatever OEMs that are delivering services on the private cloud space. So this service chaining is something that is achievable today with Cisco ACI and the Palo Alto Networks platform. So every time you look at, let's say, an NSX or an ACI, make sure that you have the necessary security controls and architecture in place for securing those workloads.
So means if that solution takes care of microservices, you will also take care of the microservices issue, right?
Correct.
So in a way, if there is something, an application-centric architecture which takes care of microservices meshed architecture, you will by default will basically take care of that.
Correct.
Okay.
Yeah, so I think I've more or less come to the end of my discussion. And I'll need maybe 5 minutes of your undivided attention just to give you a brief of what Palo Alto Networks is looking for in the future. I covered it in bits and pieces during my answers to a couple of questions. But like I told you, point number one, Palo Alto Networks does not believe that we will be able to solve all your security issues. Because the security industry is so dynamic and the threats are changing in such a manner that we can't keep pace. And if you look at RSA conference that happened a couple of months ago, there were maybe 300 or 400 different security vendors. And all of them were hot kids on the block. All of them had niche technologies that could maybe change the way security was consumed. So that was when we decided to take a step back and say, let's not try to solve all the security problems. Let's create a platform that can solve security problems for customers. So which basically means Palo Alto Networks will modify itself or transform itself into an operating platform where you can consume a security service of your choice. So how do we do this? Security is logs. This was also something that I covered a little earlier. Every security incident that you see within your enterprise today is a log. It can be on public cloud, it can be on a SaaS application, it can be on your endpoint, it can be on your network perimeter, anywhere. Finally, if your security team needs to take action on something, it is based on a log, correct? And today, what do you do with your logs? Your logs from your firewall, from your IPS, from your endpoint, from your cloud infrastructure, everything flows down to an SIEM. Am I right? And that SIEM has pre-written rules saying, in case this sequence of events happens, then create an incident and then mark it for action, correct? The problem there is, each of these individual devices that are sending logs has its own limited context. For example, if you take a URL filtering solution's logs, they are severely limited to the URL categories that users are accessing. If you take a firewall log, it is limited to IP address and port that a specific session is establishing, which means it's extremely fragmented. And an SIEM looks at each of these different logs separately and tries to make sense out of it. It worked well. It still works well. But what we are trying to do is, we are there at the network. We are there on the cloud. And we are there on the endpoint. If we decide to change the way we define the network controller, the endpoint security system and cloud, we can function as one, the detector or the sensor, and two, the enforcer. Which means that as Palo Alto Networks on the firewall, we will send out every single network log that is required for you to do security analytics on. Any advanced logs also that are needed, we will start consuming and we will send that all to something called a logging service that will sit on top. This logging service is a cloud-based service and it will consume these logs from everywhere. It will consume it from the network layer. It will consume process level, thread level, user level information from the endpoint, and it will consume all the logs from your cloud infrastructure also. So suddenly what do you have? Rather than all of these security devices sending siloed logs to an SIEM, you have one single log framework that has all the logs that you need to do analytics or response or prevention on. And what we did on top of that is start creating applications. So when we said we'll create applications, we didn't say we will create all the applications. When we acquired a company, I covered Evident.io, which I said was Evident Security. We wrote that as an application. But what we said is, any security OEM who wants to start writing applications for customers' logs can write on top of this application framework. So which basically means that, let's assume you have a new endpoint EDR.
Yeah.
You said EDR.
Yeah.
You have an EDR solution that requires you to implement an agent on, let's say, 15,000 endpoints that you currently use. For you to do a POC of those 15,000 endpoints, understand what value it brings, and then roll it out on your organization, it takes 6 months.
Yeah.
And that application provider might be a very niche player.
Yeah.
He might have, let's say, 50 employees.
Yeah.
He will not be able to support you.
Yeah. Yeah.
So what we said is, your logs are anyway available on the logging service. And these logs are what you need to do your EDR.
Yeah.
Write your application on top of the application framework and let your customer consume it. So it changes the way security will be consumed. So we have 30 different players who've signed up with us already, which includes the like of IBM and Phantom, FishMe, all of these, where all of these OEMs are writing applications for us, which you can consume. So imagine a scenario where all your enterprise logs are available to you, and you can consume any application just like you consume applications the way I told you. When I said, please download Kahoot app from the Android store, all you did was click, download, and install. 5 minutes, you are up and running. The same way, consuming applications off of the application framework. This is where we as Palo Alto Networks are headed. Making sure that we continue as a platform, allowing you to ingest logs from elsewhere also, that is the vision, and allowing you to consume any security service that you want. It need not be ours.
And I think this is a very good summary of platformization of technology, where because of the abilities that you bring to the together, so there are a lot of outcomes that it delivers. So participation is very important outcome, right? Democratization is very important outcome delivering. So many players, small players with 10, 15 employees have some ideas to work on. So these platforms are available for them to experiment, right, and innovate on that one. So it also democratized the way basically entire technology landscape will be changing. And then more importantly, it reduces the initial barriers as well. If you really have some good idea use case, rather than building from the scratch, you just use the ready-to-use platform and build that use case in some technical piece which can be consumed by the globe. And that is how this entire theme of these best practices meet is basically we thought of how evaluations is happening. And this is a really good summary, Suvin, that at the end that you really brought to the table, how each of those key technology players all across the globe had been really evolving from the point solution or many point solutions to a platform where not only they solve the problem, key problems, but they also make the platform available for others to work on their own problem or probably work on some of the new problem that they can solve. So this is how the entire technology ecosystem in other areas and security is also going. And this is a really a key summary of how things are happening in cybersecurity space as well.
So with that, I end my presentation. My phone number is there below in case you guys want to note it.
Yeah.
And I'll be available after the during lunch also.
Yeah.
So we've got 15 minutes. Let's see if we can get the quiz running. And I've got prizes for the top three. All right? All of you have installed the app? Or all of you who are participating have installed the app? Let's go.
So we need to have a lot of disclaimer nowadays because of privacy, right?
One second.
Can anybody help with the audio?
1 second. Yeah.
You connections and data in the cloud. Nothing? A little something? Whatever.
Came all right. The cloud? I've got 14, 15,
you
16,
should
17,
know that without securing your applications 18, 19, and data 22, properly,
22
your happy, safe,
that's the pin that you need to give on the app.
Can turn into a bad, bad
27
cloud.
27 players.
28,
29,
29 30,
30,
it could start associating with the wrong crowd,
36,
like malware and identity thieves.
7, 38.
It could easily give up customer credit card data. And God forbid, hijack your 90, infrastructure, leaving 40, you and
yes,
your corporate 50. Pals with the
minimum.
In
yes,
no
50
time,
minimum.
Your cloud could be aiding
anyone else still
all
joining?
Kinds of cyber mischief. But not if you have next generation security from Palo Alto Networks.
So the
we
first question will be
Azure, Office 365,
no
AWS,
marks, no
and much,
prizes
much
question.
More.
Because
total
I want you to get used to the format of the quiz. And the next 10
out
will be
identify
four prizes.
All your applications.
Please note,
while
the faster you answer,
before
the more you
happen.
Get. And your name will get shown as who's the leader at the
preventing
end. Okay?
Don't let
oh, we've hit 50.
Applications
all right.
Turn your good
so we'll
cloud
start.
Bad.
Yes.
Start securing your cloud today.
All right. Okay? So that's the question. Uh-oh. One second. Something wrong. I am sorry. I lost my network.
So they are getting questions in their application?
I am sorry, you guys will need to re-register.
You have to do again?
Yes, I'm really sorry about that. I was connected to my VPN. Yeah. Please, I'm really sorry.
So they have to again enter
cloud,
the PIN or what?
Accelerator
yeah, you'll have to
of new application deployments. A friend to those who desire true agility. A hero to those who require scalability.
One,
a true
one,
corporate champion and a trusted friend to
two,
all. But you already
quick,
know
quick,
it's
quick,
fantastic.
Quick, quick.
So, what
we have
are
only 10
you
minutes,
doing
we'll
to secure your applications and data in the cloud? Nothing? A little something? Whatever. Came with the cloud? Well, you should know that without securing your applications and data properly, your happy, safe, reliable corporate cloud can turn into a bad, bad cloud virtually overnight. It could start associating
50.
With the wrong crowd,
right?
Like
so
malware
I start.
And identity thieves.
Anyone else
it
joining?
Could easily give up customer credit card data.
All done.
And God forbid,
start.
Hijack your...
Start.
So I hope my network does not give up on me today. Okay, so that's the question. So these are the options that you will get. You just need to select the correct option.
Okay.
All right. So that's just setting the tone. I had three correct answers. Did any of you answer to eat chicken biryani? Who answered? All right. So from now on, questions are serious. You guys will be scored. Here we go. Harsha AR. So no, nobody's got scores. All right. Which feature provides a global private communication space in Google Cloud? Peer networking infrastructure, identity access management, express route, or VPC? I gave this one question 30 seconds because it was long. Up. 24 of you got it right. The answer was VPC. Moving on, let's look at who scores. Visa 916. Who is that? Okay, so moving on, next question. When a firewall is running in an AWS or Azure cloud, what cost must you consider? Compute, power, cooling, or space? 38, most of you got it right, cost of compute. Because a lot of us, when we do discussions on cloud, you look at the price that we charge you for the firewall, but you don't look at the underlying cost of compute. So that is what is critical when you look at cloud infra. And that is one of the overrun costs that you were talking about earlier. You don't assume that it costs you so much. Ansar has taken the lead, 1865. Visa has dropped down to third place. Moving on. What is the full form of UDR in Azure? Six of you got it right this time. User-defined routes. Anish Charyan, 2881. Followed. Oh, Visa's come up second place now. Which of the following statements are true about Panorama? Panorama is our management platform. I covered this in a little bit of detail when I started discussing. Sorry for that, some connectivity issues. But like I told you, single management platform for all your infrastructure is what is important. In case we ask you to install a separate management instance for each of your clouds, it will become a problem, which is why it can be deployed on-premise or on cloud. It can manage all firewalls, and you do not require a separate management instance for each of your clouds. Visa's on top, 3860, Anish Charyan, second spot. How many regions does AWS offer services from today? I checked this yesterday, and I hope I'm right. 10, 25, 18, or 8? Some of you said 25. It's not actually 25. Okay, there's not much of a change in the leadership as of now. Okay. Which of the following are protected using an AWS web application firewall? Application identification, unknown threat prevention, SQL injection, or cross-site thing. There are two right answers. You can select any one. Yep, 15 plus 14, 29 of you got it right. 14 plus 9 got it wrong. So the web application firewall, which is one of AWS's offerings, it provides you layer 7 protection against web attacks only. It will not provide you protection against malware. It will not protect you against that application ID. It will not give you application identification. Som, now we have a new leader. Moving on.
Quite a change.
Which of the following is a virtual machine workload in NSX? Edge service gateway, distributed logical router, distributed firewall, all of the above. Edge service gateway, only three of you got it right. You assumed that all of the above was the right answer. The distributed logical router and firewall are basically NSX components that reside on the layer itself. They are not a separate virtual machine that is loaded. Deepak, new guy on top.
So one question changes a lot, right?
Yeah. So it's basically how fast you answer, that's the reason why.
Yeah, means the speed is an important part, yeah.
Where is the public to private IP address translation done for inbound internet traffic? On the AWS VPC, Palo Alto Networks firewall, internet gateway, VPC edge, or virtual gateway. Who answered Palo Alto Networks firewall?
That's a
trick question.
Loyalty you create because of 2 hours of session.
I hope that translates into business for us. So internet gateway is the right answer there.
Scoreboard,
Deepak on top. Which is the biggest concern that affects customers according to the Palo Alto Networks report? This I covered in the presentation. If you've been paying attention, you should answer this.
Everybody will probably get a right.
Oh my God, all of you did. Thank you for that.
And the last question.
Once again, back to my presentation. Which is the biggest operational challenge that customers are facing when moving to cloud? Pace of application deployment, flexibility, visibility, or policy enforcement? Right, so I guess it did make sense to them. 36 of you got it right.
Yeah.
Thank you.
So, and the winner is?
Bharat.
Who is Bharat?
Som. So, Bharat and Som, please contact us after we close the session.
Yeah.
And give us your contact details for us to send you some goodies for that. Thank you very much for your time,
people.
Thank you very much. For the first time.
I think before we close, Suvin.
I didn't want to close. For the first time in my life, I stopped when there's 10 seconds remaining on the clock.
So I think this is a basic intent of doing this kind of in-depth workshop. I hope we could able to go to the depths of the topic that we discuss. We are able to cover the breadth actually as well. And also look at how exactly technology evolutions are happening and probably start appreciating what the platformization of security is evolving and how the different technology players are approaching it. So to help us conduct this kind of sessions, which takes us to deep, players like Palo Alto becomes very crucial because they build the technology and as well as they build this content for discussion with us and even take the questions as well. So I really thank Suvin and Deepak there and Palo Alto team for helping us to set up this session. And because of them, we could even think about doing this kind of session. And thank you all for all of those kind of initial expectations that you express and the questions that you ask. And I hope this entire platformization of security, which is the theme of today's discussion, you will get to see various different dimensions at a very larger micro level as well as the individual micro level as well. I mean, for example, in the tomorrow session, you will even look at what is the endpoint specific platformization initiative which is happening. You may also look at what exactly it is shaping the platformization, shaping the society. So there are some social, economical, those kind of things also will be discussed tomorrow. So thanks for joining for today, and thanks to Palo Alto team. In the afternoon, those who are, so we are doing a session, a particular session, which is on women in security. I request all of those gender representing women probably would like to join that session. There's a from 2 to 5. So there's a lot of interesting that we are doing, and that is also a very interesting technical discussion as well as how exactly women are contributing to the subject of security and privacy. So please join that session, and there is another discussion on a GDPR or privacy on larger kind of a town hall session that we are doing on privacy. So you all are welcome to join those sessions, and in the afternoon, in the evening, 4:30 to 5:30. So it's a small session that we are putting together for something DSA is building for privacy assurance. So you are also welcome to join that session. So thank you, and probably I'm sure that this particular session has helped you to understand and appreciate what is happening from the network security side and from the overall platformization of security side. And with this, I think we kick off the entire 2 days of best practices meet. Thanks, Palo Alto. Thank you all. And we break for the lunch. And after lunch, we join whatever your interest is. Please join the respective session and workshop that is there in the afternoon. Thank you all. Thank you.